There we go. What's that?
But everyone is welcome, and we know that there are a few guests with us this morning. We say Welcome to you as we gather together in this place. We pray that you find the hand of friendship here as we gather together. And we also invite you to stay following worship and go downstairs for coffee and treats and more fellowship as we gather together. As we are welcoming back more and more of our snowbirds and travelers, it's wonderful that you have come back, and the sun is out and spring is soon here. So thank you for that as we gather together. You may not have had a chance to look at our bulletin over the weekend. Those of you that are computer savvy and look at the bulletin that way, it didn't come out till late last night due to copy machine problems and lots of other things going on around here. But you have it now, and you can take a look through that. Reminder that this Wednesday is our last Wednesday service of Lent, the last service of the Golden Evening Prayer, as we will be welcoming the dancers back from Manavant Studios, as far as a couple other dancers will be joining them as well. And speaking of dancing, if any of you feel inclined to do a little dancing for worship, Saturday morning we will be getting together at 9 o'clock in the morning with Heather from the dance studio, and we will be learning a dance and hopefully doing that dance on Palm Sunday during worship. And Palm Sunday is already next Sunday. And what that means is Holy Week is right around the corner. So we remind you of Holy Week coming up. As we've always said, Easter means a whole lot more to us if we go through the darkness of Holy Week. Monday, Thursday, Good Friday, the crucifixion, darkness, and all of that. Then on Easter Sunday, we look forward to that beautiful, gorgeous sunshine and the message that Jesus is risen. So we look forward to this time of the year, and pray that you do as well as we move ahead in our schedule. Are there other joys or concerns today that anyone would care to share with us? You're all pretty quiet. Well, thanks to those who make worship possible, Dorothea, Baron Yorgenvinge, and Don, and let's see, Christy will be doing our kid talk this morning, and just to remind you that it is noisy offering, so if you need to start digging for that change or those bills, go ahead and do that, because that will happen during the kid talk. And thanks as well to all who are a part of worship this morning. Linda will be being our cantor this morning, and it's good to see all of you here as we sing and pray and gather together as one body of Christ. So let us stand, if you will, and face our cross as we stand in the shadows of that cross and take a moment of reflection, and then we will confess our sins and wait to hear those words of forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who gathers us in the wilderness to redeem us, anoint us, and make us new.
Amen.
As we come down the home stretch of these 40 days, let us be honest, confess our sin, and receive God's promise of mercy. God at the margins,
we have wandered far from your home. Again and again, we lose our way. We turn inward, afraid of the world around us. We forget that you have saved your people before and promised to do so again. Do not remember the deeds of our past, but turn our faces toward the future, where your forgiveness is sure, your welcome is clear, and your love overflows.
Amen. Like a hen who gathers her chicks, God embraces you in tender care. Like manna in the desert, God feeds you with surprising mercy. Like a loving parent, God runs to meet you again this day, forgiving your sins for the sake of Christ, leading you from death to life. Amen. As you're standing this morning, take a moment and share the peace of the Lord with one another, and that your sins are forgiven.
Peace of the whole world.
new way in the wilderness, and your grace waters our desert. Open our hearts to be transformed by the new thing that you are doing, that our lives may proclaim the extravagance of your love given to all. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Ms. Eve. Very good. Yeah. Today we're going to be talking about smelling. Do you know that being able to smell is a wonderful God-given gift? Do you have some favorite fragrances, some favorite smells? Yeah. What are your favorite smells? So some people found fault with Mary for using such an expensive perfume in that way. But Jesus accepted what she had done as a gift and recognized that she was honoring him. There are many ways to honor God. Enjoying all our senses, all five of them, is a way to honor God. So let's close with a prayer. Hands and repeat after me, dear God. Let your thanks fill the house like the fragrance of perfume. Amen. Thank you. I hope we didn't do that, but that's okay. Because it's time for noisy offerings. So the buckets are ready. Everyone wants to grab buckets. And grown-ups, if you want to get your coins ready. Or your dollars. sense of smell as well. Ready, Stevie? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. All right. Thanks to all of you, boys and girls, for collecting the noisy offering, and to all of you who put it into the buckets. Oh, here comes some more. Thank you. All right. Let's continue with the reading of the lesson. Thanks, Ryan.
The reading is from Isaiah, chapter 43. The prophet declares that long ago the Lord performed mighty deeds and delivered Israel from Egyptian bondage through the waters of the sea. Now the Lord is about to do a new thing, bringing the exiles out of Babylon and through the wilderness in a new exodus. Thus says the Lord, who makes a way in the sea, a path in the mighty waters, who brings out chariot and horse, army and warrior. They lay down, they cannot rise. They are extinguished, quenched like a wick. Do not remember the former things, or consider the things of old. I am about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. The wild animals will honor me, the jackals and the ostriches. For I give water in the wilderness, rivers in the desert, to give drink to my chosen people, the people whom I formed for myself, so that they might declare my praise. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, the home of Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. There they gave a dinner for him. Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those at the table with him. Mary took a pound of costly perfume, made of pure nard, anointed Jesus' feet, and wiped them with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, the one who was about to betray him, said, "Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and the money given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. He kept the common purse and used to steal what was put into it. Jesus said, "Leave her alone. She bought it so that she might keep it for the day of my burial. You always have the poor with you, but you do not always have me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Will you pray with me? This morning, Jesus, you tell us you are going to do a new thing. You don't remember the things of old, our sins, our past, but allow us to see you in perhaps a different light and to give extravagantly of what you have given us so that we can make a difference amongst your people here on earth, so that we can love one another as you loved, and so that your good news will be known to all. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. It's a well-known story, I'm sure, especially amongst all of you who come to first service and have been in Bible study upon Bible study. And the story speaks in different ways to all of us. And each time we read this story or hear this story, perhaps something different happens. At least that's what God intends by his word coming to us, living like a two-edged sword, piercing our hearts. And today, our prayer is that indeed this story will pierce our hearts and perhaps make something new within us as we move forward. It seems to be a familiar place where Jesus liked to go. He was amongst friends, as we all know. Remember how he loved Lazarus. When he came a few days too late and Lazarus had already died, and there again we have the smell, the stench that was coming from him. And yet, Jesus cried. He sobbed, as in the Greek says. He gasped for air because he loved Lazarus so much. And Martha and Mary as well, as they came running to Jesus after Lazarus had died and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." And yet Jesus turned around and he went in to see Lazarus and he raised Lazarus from the dead and said, "Unbind him." And there you have it. But it was also the place where Martha, and we have to be careful here because there's a lot of Marthas in our midst, as you all know. There's a lot of you who like to spend time in the kitchen, being hospitable, fixing food, serving it, making sure that all are treated well. That's obvious around here. And we don't want to take anything away from you, Marthas, because that's your gift. And that's the way you give. But remember what Jesus said to Mary when Martha was upset because Mary was just sitting there? Let her be. Let her be. She is sitting at the feet of Jesus, hearing Jesus' word. She is taking it all in, and she needed to do that. And sometimes we as well need to just be. Just sit at the feet of Jesus and listen and hear his word and smell the fragrance of whatever that might be. But there are other times when we need to perhaps be Marthas and get up and do something and serve. And Mary, well, this time, Mary felt in her heart, way down in her heart, a love that was so extravagant, so lavish, that she gave her all. She gave her best to Jesus. Perhaps she realized, more so than the rest of them, that Jesus talked about going to Jerusalem and being crucified and dying. Maybe she heard that and she understood that and she had to do something about it. Maybe the rest just didn't get it. Remember how many times he told the disciples what he must do, how he must go to Jerusalem and in 3 days be raised after he's crucified. And yet the disciples just didn't get it. Back in the day of all Norwegians, we used to say, those disciples, they must have been Norwegian, right? It just took them a while to understand. But maybe for the first time, the Holy Spirit had stirred in the heart of Mary that this was going to happen. This Jesus, whom she loved, was really going to die. Maybe she understood that. Or maybe she felt from the depths of her heart the gratefulness that her brother Lazarus was now alive. Perhaps that was it. Lazarus, who was dead, is now alive amongst them. Or perhaps, as we look at the other gospel lessons, and Mary is not named, but it sounds like it is a woman of the night. Some have even said she might be a prostitute, but she has realized that her sins, her past, has been completely forgiven by this Jesus. And she is so grateful. Remember that story where it talks about how one who is forgiven much loves much. One who is forgiven little loves little. And the more that we're forgiven, the more we want to give back in love and extravagance, don't we? And today, I think to look upon this story of Mary breaking out this bottle of costly perfume. And just to give you a sense of it, they said it was worth 300 days' wages, perhaps a whole year of wages. And there's just something about the spontaneity of Mary's heart and how she broke it open and dumped it on Jesus' feet and then dried it with her hair. When's the last time you've done something like that? Most of us are pretty well staged, aren't we? We just sort of go through life and we do what we need to do and we take care of what we need to take care of. But how many of us have really just gone for it completely? And I think that's why Dorothy and I love this time of the year, March Madness, where you can watch those basketball players lay it all out on the court. I don't know if any of you were watching last night, but there was a player that just was hitting his head on the floor and hitting his head on other players, and he even went for the ball one time and he landed on the score table, and he had to leave for a while after he got hurt. But then he came back, jogging back in, giving it all. And there's something about giving it all that speaks to this story of Mary and giving it all for Jesus. If you were able to go to the men's chorus on Friday night or Saturday night, last night, where they served the meal and then they sang for you, I wasn't able, but I've already heard stories of those who have been there and how those men, Ron amongst them, Warren amongst them, lay it all out and they sing their heart out for the people that are gathered there. That's how they love lavishly. They give it all. And when we think about what God has given us, what is it that we can give back to God that we can extravagantly lay it all out so that Jesus can know that it is our heart? I have said time and time again, as we go through our stewardship campaigns and drives and all of that, that Jesus does not want your money. And for some reason, we here in this nation, in this world, somehow think it's all about money. And it's not at all about money. Jesus wants our heart. And once he gets our heart, he gets everything. Then money just comes, and money isn't important anymore. What's important is how we love Jesus by our actions, by what we do, by what we say, by how we get along with other people, and how we love lavishly. Every now and then, you with no context at all, just lays it all out and gives it away. Isn't that wonderful to hear? Now, I think I'm probably aging myself, because some of you have talked about this too, but one of the first things I do after devotions in the morning is go online to the leader telegram and hit the obituaries. And I read those obituaries mostly because I want to know if any of them are connected to you in one way or another, or connected to the church. And as I read those obituaries, I hear those stories of what people's passions are, of what their loves are, of what they cared about. And more of those people are not necessarily having their services in church, but they're having those services or memorial times in the funeral home, the celebration centers as we have in Altoona now, or in the VFW or the Legion or someplace like that. And they want people to tell their story, to talk about them and what difference they might have made in the lives of others. And we can find out what their passions are by reading those obituaries. This last week, there were a couple of them that were actually written by the person that died. Might be something you want to think about, that you could write your own. That way no one else is going to write it for you and they'll mess it all up, right? You can write what you want to write. And when it comes down to it, it really doesn't matter, because God knows your heart. And God wants your heart, and he sees into that. So it doesn't matter what other people think. What matters is how extravagant we have been with the gifts that God has given us, and how we have shared those gifts with others. And time again, as you read those stories of people, and as I go around visiting our older people, I am just amazed. But not only amazed, but honored that I can be a part of their story. What they have done, where they have been, how they have loved Jesus in the midst of their life. And sometimes it's not been an easy life. Most of the time it hasn't been an easy life. But somehow in the midst of that story, their faith comes alive. And that faith comes alive much like Mary's faith came alive on this day when she opened up that costly ointment and dumped it all over Jesus' feet in an anointing of his burial to come. But more than an anointing, it was her heart that she was giving it all to God. And then I start asking the question, especially in our confession time, have I given my heart to God? What have I done to make a difference? Am I willing to extravagantly, one day, just give it all and lay it all out? Most of us would say, well, no, we have to take care of our families, right? Because our families, our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren, they're the most important, and we need to help them out. But perhaps the way that we can help them out is by passing on our faith and showing them how much Jesus means to us by what we lavishly lay it all out for him and give back to him. Because when we look at what Jesus did for us, he didn't hold anything back. He loved deeply. He gave his best. He gave his all, 110% if you can, for our sake, to forgive our sins, so that we could know one day what it means to be a member of his kingdom, to be connected to him through our heart and through our soul and through our spirit as the Spirit comes upon us. So this week, I want you all to think about, how can you give lavishly and completely and give it all back to Jesus? How you can do something out of the ordinary, something that other people will look upon upon you like Judas looked upon Mary and say, that's crazy. Why would she waste all that money, that expensive perfume on Jesus? Why? Wouldn't it be great if everyone could look at us and say, boy, did we waste that on Jesus? How wonderful would that be? So again, the plea is that we hear in Scripture that God is doing a new thing. What's the new thing that God is doing in your heart? Is the Holy Spirit stirring your heart so that you want to give lavishly and extravagantly like Mary? To lay it all out, knowing that in the end, this is all that will matter. It won't matter how many stocks and bonds and what our numbers are in our checking account and our savings account. All that will matter is our relationship with Jesus and how much we loved him. And how do we love? We love as Jesus loved, as we will find out once again on Monday, Thursday, the night before Jesus was led to the cross to be crucified, that he got down on his knees and he washed the disciples' feet. It was almost as if he anointed their feet so that he could show to them that this is how you love. This is how you lavishly and extravagantly love me by loving others. There are so many in our congregation, in this community, that need to know that Jesus loves them, young and old alike. And we need to hear that call to love one another as we have been loved and realize that we will never be able to love like Jesus loved, but we can certainly lay it all out and give our best. And we can do this. Jesus calls us to love one another, no matter what. Now, many of us will find ourselves going home and talking over the dinner table, perhaps with someone who is with us, our family member, a friend. And as I've always said, you'll have roast preacher. And you'll talk about the preacher and the sermon. And you'll talk about how can we do that? How could we ever love like Mary? How could we ever give a whole year's wages up? How could we ever give to the poor? And then we realize as we end today with that prayer that many groups end with, AA groups, other groups that come together, they end with this: God, grant me the serenity to accept the things that I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. But I like this version better. This is by a Jesuit priest, James Martin. It says, God, grant me the serenity to accept the people I cannot change, which is pretty much everyone. Since I'm clearly not you, God, at least not the last time I checked. And while you're at it, God, please give me the courage to change what I need to change about myself, which is frankly a lot, since once again, I'm not you, which means I'm not perfect. It's better for me to focus on changing myself than to worry about changing other people, who, as you'll no doubt remember me saying, I can't change anyway. Finally, give me the wisdom to just shut up. Whenever I think I'm clearly smarter than everyone else in the room, that no one knows what they're talking about except me, or that I alone have all the answers, basically, God, grant me the wisdom to remember that I'm not you. Holy Spirit, help us change our hearts so that we can turn them over completely to you as Mary did. Teach us, Holy Spirit, to love lavishly and extravagantly, and to give it all back to you after we see what you've given us. In Jesus' name we pray.
believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated as we begin our time in prayer. Seeking the grace, mercy, and love of Almighty God, we offer our prayers for the church, for people in need, and for all creation. God of resurrection and new life, inspire your church to reconsider what makes us holy. Allow us, O Lord, as Spirit, to realize what our passions really are. What do we care about? What works us up? What gets our heart and our life and our soul moving? And may we move as we go forth with the help of your Holy Spirit. When we focus on our own piety or other sins, show us Christ's faithfulness. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Wherever destruction by flood, famine, or fire has devastated land and lives, cause green shoots to spring up, giving hope and vision for your promised future. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Where nations are embroiled in chaos and unrest, cut a clear path for your people to follow. Lead us in ways of reconciliation and foretell the new things that you prepare for all of us. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Wipe away the tears of those who weep under the burdens of hard labor and despair. Restore them and bring them into the joy of your promise. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
For those that gather in the valley of the shadow of darkness and death, allow them to fear not, for you are with them. Be especially with Dale and Barbara, with Ruth and Cleo and Barbara and Lowell, with Rebecca and Dwight and Greg and Marion and Richard and Kurt and Betty and John. Be with Dale, be with Darren, be with Luann, with Susie, with Larry, with Bill, with Margaret, with Tracy, with Scott, with Michelle, with Star, and Karen, and Charisse. Be with Jeanette, be with Tim, be with Penny, be with Iva, and be with others that we name out loud or in our hearts at this time. That's a lot of people, Lord. That's a lot of names. But you know each one of them, their cares and their concerns. And we pray that your presence would be known to each of them, their caregivers, their families, and that your healing power would come upon them. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
So permeate this world with the sweet perfume of Christ's anointing. Fill your people with such gratitude that it spills over into service of those who are poor or in any need. Accompany those for whom death draws near. Bring us with all your saints to receive the abundance of heavenly glory through the covenant Christ sealed in his death and resurrection. Reveal your will as you receive our prayers and conform our ways to your ways through the saving work of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We continue our prayers as we receive our gifts and offerings at this time to further the kingdom of God. Provider, you have not fed us with bread alone, but with words of grace and life. Bless us and these your gifts, which we receive from your bounty through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. In spite of our sinfulness, Jesus still loves us and forgives us. And he comes to us through his death and resurrection. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Together we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
You may be seated as our communion offers come forward. All are welcome at the table this day. We will commune with real bread today, as in we will see the bread and take that, and then you can have a cup of wine, which is dark, or grape juice, which is light. If you prefer to stay in your seats, someone will come around and commune you. The table is already. Let us eat.
Thank you.
Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you always in his amazing grace, loving extravagantly. Amen. Compassionate God, you have fed us with the bread of heaven. Sustain us in our Lenten pilgrimage. May our fasting be hunger for justice, our alms a making of peace, and our prayer the sign of grateful hearts. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Peace. Remember the poor.
Thanks be to God.